Hey, what's up, everybody? Welcome back to another hot topic on He Say, She Say with your girl, CoCo J.
And your boy, man, the hood, Howard Stern, Q Lewis. Definitely lovely to be back in the building, some of us outside the building. But
there you go.
That's a little inside joke there. But yeah, welcome everybody back to another episode of He Say, She Say. Don't forget, man, it's always Social Media Friday. So if you got social media, make sure you follow the host. All right, so check out CoCo J at Hey, It's CoCo J on Instagram and Twitter. And, of course, you can follow your boy, man, the hood, Howard Stern. I was about to say Q Lewis. The hood, Howard Stern, man, on Instagram and Twitter as well. And don't forget, if you got Facebook, you can also like our fan page. All right, so it's the He Say, She Say. Right there on Facebook, you can go there and like our fan page and see some of the stuff we'll be posting there in between time about the shows. But, lovely to be back in the building, man. It's in the 40s again in Colorado. Just wanted to say that. and next week is going to be in the 50s. So I'm feeling like you bringing the good weather with you. But, you know, that's a whole other conversation. So what's been going on with you, though, since last week? You know, so it's been a long week. It's been 7 days.
Let's see. Well, we just celebrated my youngest birthday, my youngest baby, Jordan. He just turned 9. So his birthday was on the 3rd Wednesday. So we went to eat. Him and auntie, uncle, his little cousins, and his aunties. So that was cool. He enjoyed himself, and he got some games and stuff and money for his birthday, so he was excited. And then, the weekend, just planning the weekend, he going to Sky Zone and then ice cream and cake at the house. But other than that, so it was cool. But other than that, nothing much, same old thing.
Same old thing. Okay.
Yeah,
How's the weather been there?
You know what, it's cool. I'm still not going to complain. I don't think the day before yesterday, we had some pretty decent weather.
Okay.
The day before yesterday. I want to say it was in the 50s, maybe.
Okay. Yeah, I've seen people on Facebook barbecuing, so.
Yeah, so it was pretty cool. Once
you know
again,
how
I'm
we
not.
Do.
Right. The minute the sun shines, it gets a little warm. But yeah, like I said, I'm not going to complain because the weather, okay, this winter has not been bad at all. So thank God for that.
Right, definitely.
So hopefully we'll continue to, it will stay that way.
Yeah, I feel it. Ain't nothing wrong with that. Now, I know a couple or maybe about 3 or 4 days ago, we got about all together, probably around 16 inches of snow up in the mountains. Of course, they got more than that. But it's strange out here, though, because it can snow all day and you get, like, this big lump sum of snow, but then, like, the next day it's gone. Like, it's weird like that. So I can't complain about that either. And like I said, next week we're going to be in the 50s, you know, almost 60. So shit, I definitely can't complain about that, you know, 60-degree weather.
Right. I definitely can't wait since I will be there.
That's right. Yeah. And I can't wait to see you on Tuesday. You know what I'm saying?
Me
so,
too.
Yeah, so we get to do the show live for real, you know what I'm saying, from the same place. So that'd be a good thing. What else been going on though? Anything? I know you watch a lot of Netflix and stuff. What's your movie game been looking like lately?
You know what, I haven't watched. Let me see. What was the last movie? You know what, I seen this movie called Gone Girl, I believe it is, with Ben Affleck. Man, that movie was so good. I think, I'm not sure how old it is. I want to say, you know what,
it's a few years old.
It's a couple years old. I want to say 2014, 15, something like that. But it was so good. And I didn't expect for it to be that good. I was just like, I couldn't find nothing else, so I just clicked on that. But it was pretty good. And then before then, I seen Get Hard with Kevin Hart.
Oh, okay, Get Hard.
Did we talk about that last time?
Oh, yeah, we
time?
Did. You
we
seen
talked
that
about
before
that.
Last time.
Right,
yeah,
before then.
Right.
So after that, I seen Get Hard with, what's the other guy's name?
Kevin Hart. Oh,
Kevin Hart and who else? I forgot his name.
Yeah, I know, right? I can't think of his name. That's my guy, though.
Right.
Yeah, I cannot think of his name for some reason.
And then the wedding ringer. So I've been kind of catching up, because I don't go to the, as you already know, I don't like the show like that. I don't go to the show.
Oh,
so.
you've been getting your Kevin Hart fix, huh?
Yeah. He definitely got him coming in, so.
Oh, yeah, definitely. So, yeah, we got to catch Ride Along, too, when you get here as well. Since I waited because you asked me to. I wanted to go see it myself, but I waited. So.
That's very sweet of you. I really appreciate it.
Mm-hmm. I'm glad you appreciate it, because it won't happen again.
Yeah, okay.
Next time a movie come out, I'm going to see it when it come out.
Uh-oh.
Anyway, but yeah, so I watched Get Hard, too, so I hadn't seen it before. It was pretty funny. And I cannot think of, that's my guy. I cannot think of
And
his
I know,
name.
Will, I want to say,
Will
I was
Ferrell,
about to say
yeah.
Will Ferrell.
Will Ferrell, yeah.
It is? That's not, oh,
yeah,
okay.
Yeah, I know, and you're definitely not good with names, so I'm excited that you was able to even remember.
Right, that name just popped up in my head.
Yeah,
okay,
Will Ferrell,
so that's
man.
Who
yeah.
it is. Okay.
Right, and I could not think of that for my life, and that's my guy. I'm the one, mm-hmm. you know, I'm the one to be telling you about his movies. Yeah.
Right.
But myself, man, I catch that one too, you know, Get Hard, but you know what I gotta talk about, what I've seen since last week. Gotta talk about the OJ miniseries. All right, so you know, I mentioned this yesterday on my show about how I feel about the movie itself. All right, so we're gonna talk about both of those real quick before we jump off into our topic. And don't forget, if you're on eblockradio.com on the mobile app or on Blog Talk Radio, you can hit us up at 760-283-4647. We're not on topic right now, but, you know, you can jump in if you want to talk about some of the stuff we're talking about right now. You know what I'm saying? When you call in, hit that number one key, and we can bring you on. But, yeah, so the O.J. movie is starting out good. I mean, the thing is that when the O.J. trial happened, along with millions of other people, you know, I followed it, you know, when they went to court and all the proceedings up until that point and everything, you know, through to the end, you know, I kind of sat through all of it. I think most of America did, because it was such a big trial. But seeing the movie, you know, it kind of just reminded you everything that you went through in the first place. But it's a good movie, and it's funny because it's 20 years later, you figure, like, damn, I know the story. Like, why am I even watching this shit? You know what I'm saying? Because, like, I already know what it is. But I'm going to tell you like this, man. Cuba Gooding Jr., to me, like, I never would have thought him as OJ. But seeing this movie, though, like, he did a damn good OJ. Like, it was believable. Like, it wasn't Cuba Gooding Jr. no more. It was OJ. It was a wrinkle J. Simpson. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, okay.
Orenthal, for you non-sports fans, that's actually OJ's name, Orenthal. But
I didn't know that. What is it, Orenthal?
Orenthal.
Oh, that's a weird Orenthal name.
Orenthal James. That's what OJ means.
Orenthal James. Oh,
yep.
Okay.
But yeah. So I think you're doing a good job, and it show you both angles. You know, it show you him. I mean, to be honest with the movie, it started making you think, like, damn, did he really do it? Like, it makes you think a little bit. But then it also shows you the missteps from the prosecution and the police department. And I think that probably played the biggest role in him being found not guilty. I think that even at this point, I think it's safe to say, it's just my opinion, but I feel like whether he did it or not, I think that them being overzealous killed the case, regardless whether he did it or not. I think they shot themselves in the foot on that one, because they was just doing too much. You know what I'm saying? They was doing too much, which is understandable, because you're talking about at a time, especially in L.A., you know, you're talking about, you know, people with a lot of money or famous people basically for lack of a better term, getting away with murder. But I think they, you know, they focused on that. They, like, they want to use him as an example. And this happens all the time with athletes especially, but with people in power, people with money, the prosecutions and police departments always trying to set an example. And then not only that, of course, you had the abusive relationship that they had, which is well documented, that she called several times about, you know, basically the juice whooping her ass, you know what I'm saying? So I think the prosecution, what's her name, Marcia Clark, was kind of like, she, you know, because a lot of women, or I ain't gonna say a lot of women, but she was one that she wasn't in awe by OJ. Like, she didn't even know who the hell OJ was. She
okay,
just
listen.
Let him.
Huh? Don't tell it all.
I mean, it's real life.
I know it is, but I'm just saying it's probably more. It's been a while, so people probably forgot what you know, and then it's probably more detailed.
Well, it probably is more detailed. I just want to say this one last thing, though. Just that she, like I said, she just like it happened in real life. It's like to her, it was more like we not gonna let another woman be or get away. And to be honest, I think it's a lot of women. And a lot of, I hate to say it, but there's a lot of powerful positions who have these vendettas because they have seen so many go undisciplined. So then they go over the top, and it may not even be warranted in that situation. So that's all I was saying in that, you know what I'm saying? And I think that happened in a lot of things. Like, that happened in sexual harassment cases with women that work in HR sometimes. You know, it seems as though they take the woman's side because they've seen so many women be taken advantage of that this next person just gets it, and it wasn't even that kind of situation. So I think that's kind of what happened in that too. But you can check it out. But real quick too, man, I know I've been talking a lot, but it's about the OJ thing, and I just gotta say one more thing. Like I said yesterday, I still think. Excellent performances and everything, you know. But I still think that it's strategic, though. And I only say that because the OJ shit happened 20 years ago. Now, granted, it may be some reason behind that. Maybe they couldn't do certain things because maybe OJ could capitalize off of it after a certain period of time. I don't know. But with the 20-year anniversary being back in June, why not release the movie then, right? Like, why not be prepared to release it at that point? I think that there's a whole different, maybe even political agenda focused on them releasing that movie at this point in time because so many black people are upset with law enforcement and the laws themselves, and this may be a way to get the people from the other side of that argument who say, well, you know, people getting away with murder. And, of course, the political climate is changing because we're going into a new president. I know that's probably way deeper than what it was intended.
It is.
But it seemed like it, though. I mean, tell me seriously.
I mean, that's
what,
a different – that could be a whole show topic right there. So.
I know, and that's what we're talking about next week, me and Monty.
Okay.
But I'm just saying, you don't think it's a little strange, though? Like, and
I mean,
Black History Month.
That could be the case. That could be. So
I just did the Black History Month thing in there, but
right. But I mean, I feel what you're saying. That could be the case.
Yeah, it could be the case.
Yeah.
I don't know. I always find little stuff like that. I'm a conspiracy theorist. I used to see movies about, you know, conspiracy theory, and I just thought those people so crazy. But now I understand. If you live long enough, you really start questioning so many motives of anything that the government has to do with. And, well, I won't say the government. I'll say the government and people in power, because sometimes the people in power ain't the government. But that's a whole other subject right there, too, though. But anyway, all right, so enough about movies, because I can go on and on about the OJ trial. So, hey, but it's good, though. So it's on for 10 weeks, so it's like, what, 2.5 months or something? So it's on forever because it's a mini series. So it'll come on each week for the next 10 weeks. So, you know, obviously you get a chance to see it at some point because it's going to be on TV for like 3 months.
Oh, okay.
So, and that may be strategic as well. That's a whole other subject. But, yeah, I seen it. And you know what? Something I seen, that's about the topic. So we won't jump off into that. Right now, what I was just telling you about before we came on air. But outside of seeing the OJ thing, it's just been kind of chill. I haven't been doing much, you know, working. Me and my partners on the other radio show, working on some projects maybe outside of the radio show. to try to see if we can do some new things with E-Block Radio. So outside of that, outside of that and watching the OJ the OJ movie, I really haven't done anything. I guess it's been a pretty slow 7 days for me, I guess.
Oh, okay. It'd be like sometimes.
Yeah, it'd be like that sometimes, for real.
Yeah.
But what are we gonna do then? Because we got a pretty deep topic.
So we might want to jump into that.
I think we gonna jump on into that. Like we did last week, we're going to skip the commercials, and we go dive right in. So don't forget, if you're on eblockradio.com right now or on Blog Talk Radio, make sure you give us a call, 760-283-4647, and hit that number one key so we can see what's on your mind. So if you're not sure what we're talking about, if you haven't been following us on Instagram and Twitter, then you got to know the topic today is, how does sex abuse as a child affect your adult relationships? All right, so that's what we want to talk about. And the numbers are crazy. So we're gonna go through some of the numbers after we jump into it. But at this point, we just gonna have some conversation about it. So, Coco J, I mean, how do you feel about that? Like sexual abuse as a child, like how does this affect your relationships as an adult?
Well, you know what? It can affect that. I'm not I don't have my degree in psychiatrist or anything like that.
Mm.
But I would have to say that I believe when you are sexually abused as a child and as you're growing, and it has never been addressed, and then sometimes even if it has been addressed, you can definitely have some issues and all your relationships, whether it's intimate relationship, just a friendship period, and it just caused you to be going through certain things because of the past or what happened to you as a child. I believe personally that it definitely can cause some conflict if you don't get some kind of help, if that had happened to you, some type of counseling,
right.
You'll start to have trust. I believe trust issues. You won't trust anyone, and you can bring that into the relationships as you get older. Any kind of relationship, your social life. Your social life. Period can be affected
by that. Not even just the intimate relationship, but you just mean period.
Just period overall. Okay. So that can definitely do something to a child growing up, and they can feel like your self esteem can be taken. They can be stripped of their self esteem when that goes on. I mean, it goes so much can happen, and every child is different though. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So. Just because if it affects this one child over here, it may not affect the same. It's going to affect this other child over here, but just in a different way.
Right.
So if it's not addressed, counseling, seeking some kind of help. It's going to continue on. In your adult years as well, if that don't happen. And it still can. Even if you do get help, it can still just carry on throughout your whole life, and you may not even be aware of it. Because sometimes you may think that I got help, I'm over it.
And you think you dealt with it.
But then you're having these other issues in your life as an adult, in your social life, your intimate life, and you just kind of like, what the hell is going on? And that could be it. Maybe you need to dig a little deeper to figure out what's going on. So that's a very serious topic because it's still going on.
Right.
Sexual abuse,
definitely.
The molestation, people molesting these little kids, and it's real sad. And it can definitely affect you. I think that has something to do with what's going on with our young the generation today as well, because they have sexual abuse, neglect, I mean, all that ties all together because you're going to act out. You're going to act out if you don't know how to handle things like that. And as a child, you shouldn't have to handle things like that. But unfortunately.
Right. So you're not going to know how to handle it. Right.
Exactly. But unfortunately, in the world that this, the way this world is, you know, we live in, that is what's going on with our young children today. And it's sad. So it definitely will affect. And it can affect the parents involved, that's involved with, you know, the parents as well. Because they may not even know how to handle it once they find out that this is going on with their child.
And then especially it's tough to figure out how to handle it once you find out who the perpetrator is. Because oftentimes it may be a family member, you know, and that turns into its own situation. So,
yep.
I mean, for instance, let's say it's an aunt or an uncle, then that means that's one of the parents, brothers, or sisters. It turns into a totally different situation. So now, as opposed to one situation, you're actually dealing with two.
Yeah,
and then also, just on the flip side of that, is that point where, you know, some adults, this happened to some adults, is that, you know, depending upon whatever that relationship is of the person who's being accused, there may be a situation where they don't necessarily believe the child. Now, this presents a third problem.
Exactly. And
exactly.
Sad to say, a lot of that is, I believe that a lot of that is going on as well.
Oh, yeah.
To where the parents
not
believing their child, that someone that they know or someone just period, is they're telling them and they're not believing that's this person. So that even does, that right there even does something to them, like, dang, this is happening to me. I'm trying to tell my parent what's going on, and they don't believe me. So
right,
that just shut down the child instantly. And yeah, that would definitely do something to a child, period. You would be emotionally hurt, disturbed by that. So
exactly. Let's not avoid all of the angles here, because even that can be a reverse issue. All right. And what I mean by that is some of the things that you mentioned before about neglect and things of that nature. Maybe not even getting the attention that they needed can also result in a child making a false claim like that, right?
Mm-hmm.
So making a false claim like that to get that parent or, you know, that person in their life, you know, attention and affection could also ruin, you know, that parent and the other person's relationship. So it's so many dynamics there that it really is a tough one. Now, I guess the easiest thing to say is that I'll say this. I think that one is probably the easiest to control, only because if you're giving your child the attention and affection that he or she needs, then perhaps this won't, you know, that won't be something that would happen. I mean, hopefully. You know, you never know exactly how it turns out, but you figure if you're giving them at least that, then you won't have to be concerned with whether they would be lying about something like that just to get your attention. So at least I feel like you have some control in that. The other shit you honestly don't have no control in, because no matter how hard you try to get your child into the right position to be around the right people to make sure that everything checks out, shit happens. You know what I'm saying? Like, and this is a tough thing for both parties, though, because like I said, that if you're that parent who's giving your kid all the love, all the affection, all the attention, making sure that they're with, you know, uncle so-and-so or auntie so-and-so in the best schools, and I checked it out and double-checked it out, and then it still happens, then you got another issue, because now as a parent, you're going to be blaming yourself. So now you got like two damaged people. You got the damaged parent and the damaged child.
Right.
And how do you communicate after that? And see, when that communication breaks down and you blame yourself, the kid blaming themselves, because what happened too is that your kid, you know, your child will start, because it's tearing you up so much, your child will be like, damn, I wish I never said nothing. See, and then when a child thinks that, like they never should have brought that to your attention, that it's fucked up. From that point, it's fucked up. I'm sorry. I couldn't think of no other word for it.
I mean, most definitely. But it's just messed up, period, that a child will have to go through that. Now, as far as, once again, like I stated earlier, when those issues are getting brought into your relationship, when those issues are getting brought up to your adult years, then that's mm-hmm. when you know it really affected you. And
right.
and some people ignore it. Some people do ignore it because, once again, they think they got over it, but actually not, because that's something you can never, I honestly think that's something you can never get over.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be something that's always going to be in back of your head. You just have to tell your story. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. To other parents or other children. Or
right.
you know, because it's and just put it out there. And that mm-hmm. might even help that person slowly but for surely close that chapter up in their life. But it definitely it can definitely be you cannot just erase it from your mind, and then you wonder why your relationships is not, you're not having good relationships.
Right. Well, yeah, because, I mean, yeah, definitely. Because at some point, you're gonna have to rehash it. And I think that's probably a tough thing for anybody in that position, especially if, you know, if you was in a situation where you actually did come forward about it and you was either ridiculed or, you know, not, you know, nobody believes you, which is the case, you know, I don't really want to dwell on this only because, you know, Bill is innocent, but I'm just saying. But, you know, a lot of women, that was their excuses, that they didn't want to be shamed or, you know, or nobody would believe them, so that's why they waited, you know, 30 years to say something.
Right.
But I know that it is true. It's a documented behavior of mm-hmm. people who are you know, have been sexually abused. I mean, it's a documented behavior. Like, it's what people do. So, like, when people say it, like, you know, we are kind of harsh. I'm like, why the hell would you wait 30 years? But at the end of the day, though, it's been happening since day one. Like, it's documented. That's how people react. Like, it's nothing new. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? But, I mean, I just wanted to look at some of these numbers right quick, which obviously I know, unfortunately, of course, it is a little unbalanced, I guess. Of course, it's more women appear to be involved. I mean, at this point, as kids, and when they say as child abuse, they rank it as 18. Under 18. So I think at this point it's like, let me find those numbers again. Yeah, at this point is one out of every five like little girls and one in 20 of little boys. So it's not as many for boys as it is girls that experience this, but at the same time, I mean, one in a million, anything less than a million, I guess, it can happen, because you know 20 boys and you know 6 girls. So out of those 20 boys, it can be one, and out of these 6 girls, it can be one that has experience. But the thing about it is that those one in whatever numbers usually carry that with them until they become adults, and they carry that, you know, that baggage with them. Now, I mean, at this point, it says that this is a kind of scary number, though. I mean, I don't think nobody should get sexually assaulted, but I'm just saying, out of in the U.S., out of sexual assault victims, 44% of them are underage. That's almost half. Like, 44% is almost half. Yeah, underage. So out of all the people that get sexually assaulted in a year, almost half of them are kids, basically. That's a crazy number. Like,
that's a lot.
I mean,
yeah.
That's a hell of a lot. So you just figure, just just even if we use the number 100 just to keep it consistent with percentage, you say out of 100 people get sexually assaulted, 44 of them are kids. That's 44 families.
That's sad. But just to change it up a little bit, now that's just you know how you hear on the news, and it's, I'm sure it's more than that going on other than the stuff we hear on the news about these parents, these mainly women meeting these boys. Hey, I'm gonna call them boys because they definitely not men.
These
boys that's you know, touching on these young kids and the mother thinking it's okay since I've known him for a few months, I'm going to let him watch my kids. Yeah. And next thing you know, she raped, she pregnant by the dude, or he done touched her in an inappropriate way. So
right.
Is that has a lot to, I think that adds to that number as well, because we're, it's the trust is gone, and if you can't trust, you got to be careful who you leave your young kids with,
right.
And unfortunately that's even with family members, because
right.
they can be having some mental issues going on and we not even aware of it, and next thing you know they trusting your child, and then this child gonna have to deal with this for the rest of their life.
Right.
So
yeah.
The teachers, like for you, even your teachers, who the people, the kids are supposed to trust in school, even your teachers. The teachers,
oh, yeah.
the school staff, all of that. It's just like people's minds are so messed up nowadays can't even trust your children to go to school without this happening.
Right. So just to comment on what you just said right there, it say right here that 93% of them know their perpetrator, and those perpetrators consist of teachers, clergy members, or coaches. So, yeah,
see,
it's exactly
saying?
What you just said. Yeah, exactly.
And that's crazy.
Said.
And these are the people that the parents at least should trust. But me, the way it's set up now, I don't trust you like that. I don't even know you like that. You may be the coach and you may be good with dealing with kids and all that, but, hey, you just have to be careful. You have to second guess. You have to second guess because people's state of mind is, they seem cool, but then they really not. You know what I'm saying? They mental state of mind is not right.
Right.
And that's messed up. And then it can be going on in your own home as well, in your bedroom, your mama boyfriend, your cousin,
mm-hmm.
your uncle, your sister, your brother. I mean, that's just how, that just lets you know that something, hey, I'll put it out, mental illness may perhaps have something to do with it. I would say it does.
It's
got to
be, something mental
no
about a grown adult.
In their mind can do that to a child and
right.
feel okay about it. Now,
right.
it sometimes it can happen to a child if that, you know, if that grown person, not saying that this is an excuse, but maybe this grown person or maybe this the person who's ever sexual abuse and somebody been through it. You know what I'm saying? And
right,
they just
exactly.
repeating it. So it can be all kinds of reasons. And it can go so deep as far as how that shit would mess up a person, period.
Now, that I believe, though. I think that, there's no numbers on that specifically in this study. But I think that probably has a great percentage of people who have experience the same thing, and then they end up doing it to somebody else.
Yeah,
I think
that
plays a major
role in it.
Yeah,
almost
definitely. Yeah.
Now, I got a question for you. Do you think, now you, listening to the numbers as far as how many boys and girls, girls being the highest, you know, mm-hmm. has been sexual abuse, do you think for, you know, that boys, or, you know, they don't admit, as they become adults, they never told anyone, but as they become adults, they still never told anyone. Do you think it's because they will be embarrassed, that the dudes will, versus
oh, yeah.
a woman saying it, that she
oh, yeah.
was
most,
sexually abused?
Most definitely. And I say this because it's most definitely the truth. This is a stigma amongst men, especially being sexually abused by another man, all right? So let me look at the difference here. Now, it's not funny, but it's just that, like I said, when I watched The Breakfast Club, Charlamagne always talks about it because he says he was molested as a child. But he always jokes about it because it was his uncle's girlfriend or something. And he often joked about, now this may be his coping mechanism, I'm not sure. But he often joked about it as if, you know, he kind of, even though he knew that she shouldn't be doing it, he kind of felt like, not that there wasn't nothing wrong with it, but he felt some kind of way about it, but he wasn't disturbed by it. You know what I'm saying? And that may be what he says now as an adult, you know what I'm saying, maybe. But I think that most dudes, well, a lot of dudes probably feel that same way, right? Either that way, as if it didn't actually disturb them, which it really does. But once you get older, you start looking at things a different way, I think, and I think that's what makes them say that. But then also, it's just that stigma that men don't get raped. Men
yeah.
don't get taken advantage of. You know what I'm saying? Like a dude can seriously, you know, it happens. Like, a dude can get raped. You know what I'm saying? Who takes that seriously, though? So, even as a child, if you've got a strong male figure in your life, a father or, you know, uncle or big brother, even as a male child, you still are under you still have that same mentality. Like, I can't tell somebody that you know, sexually abused me. You know what I'm saying? You're talking about a kid who's maybe, let's say 9 or 10. Like, you are actually cognizant of things that go on around you at 9 or 10 at this point.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if you like a kid, like you like 5 or 6, then you might not have a clue. But you 9 or 10, you already know what it is to be a boy. You know what I'm saying? So it's certain things that's already in you that won't allow you to say nothing. So that one in 20 number may actually be kind of misconstrued because those other, you know, 5 or 6 in that 20 didn't ever tell anybody. You know, so that number could actually be wrong. It's just that dudes ain't saying nothing. You know?
Yeah, right.
Go ahead.
No, I was going to say that can be true. Because, like, I know someone who been he's a dude, but I know somebody who was I don't want to say rape, but he was sexually abused by his he was sexually abused by his cousin when he was younger. She was a few years older than him,
mm-hmm.
but he knew what was going on. I think he was about 9 or 10,
right.
But he just kind of explained to me that he thinks that's why he is how he is with females, how he go about, how he is with females now. He don't want a relationship. All he want to do is just, you know what I'm saying? He just want to do the damn thing, and that's it. And I messed him up mentally. Honestly, I don't think he realized it. Like, dude.
Right, because he kind of just seen it as, like, men don't look at it the same way. You know, I honestly think they don't. Well, like I said, especially when it involves a female. Like, if a man gets molested or sexually abused by a dude, then that changes the game. But if he's molested or sexually assaulted by a woman, I can't speak from experience, so I can only say that I think that we look at that differently. You know, I think that somehow we carry it along with us as baggage that we don't even recognize, but we don't look at it the same as a woman who has been touched by a grown man.
Right. So y'all, when it comes to that situation, y'all probably just think y'all just got it going on because y'all getting all these women or something.
See, I didn't want to say it,
but the reality of it is y'all have some deep issues going on and y'all don't want to, and some men don't want to address it. You know what I'm saying? That is what needs to be done. Take a step back and take a deep into what's going on inside of you. And that's not even, but in that case, to take a step back and take a look at yourself, that goes on with everybody who's been sexually abused, because you know you're going to be dealing with certain issues. And, right. and no matter how much you try to push that shit away, out your head, out your mind, whatever, it's still going to come up in all your relationships, intimate relationships, personal relationships, job relationships, all that. If you don't address it, if you don't confront it, because all you got to do is confront it, and it's not easy. I know it's not easy, but you still got to confront it just for the sake of, for you to be in your right mind and for you to have healthy relationships.
Exactly.
Period. And it might take time. It may not take one person no time. It may take a person a long ass time, or maybe for the rest of their life. But once you notice it and you address it and you know you got conflict in your relationships because of what happened to you as a child, but you're steady trying to address it and correct it and start to have better healthy relationships, then you're on the right path. But if you never do that, and as a young child, if your loved ones don't try to get you no help, then you're going to be lost up until you're an adult. And then hopefully when you do get an adult, you will address it yourself. But if not, then you're going down a path that you don't want to go. You're going to end up in jail, dead, or molesting somebody else, or you just want to be mental. You're going to be mentally, emotionally, you're just going to be damaged. Right. And I believe that is what's going on with our generation now, not saying particularly because of child abuse, I mean sexual abuse, but it could be all kinds of different abuse. And it's never just been addressed, and they feel like they just, you know, like they don't have anybody. They feel alone or something. You know what I'm saying? So they just out here just doing whatever.
And the crazy thing about it, though, just mentioning how you said, you know, they feel alone, the crazy thing about it, though, is that this is one of those things where, quite honestly, there is such a large number of people that have experienced it, that it should almost, you know, this is just my way of thinking, it should almost make it a little easier to come forward, because you would have so much support, because there have been way more people than you probably even know that have experienced this.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so, and I know when it happens to you, or, you know, after it happens, that perhaps you don't look at it that way, but, I mean, I think that there should be some safety in knowing that you are by no means the first one that this happened to. You know,
yeah, exactly.
Like it's some things like I say, like in reverse with the dude being molested by, you know, an older woman. Let's say you 10 and you got the older cousin that's, you know, 16 or I say grown, you know, 20 or something. You know, like still you look at it, you don't look at it the same. So that is the difference, because there is so few numbers of at least people that would admit to it, that I could see how you could feel, you know, I could see how you could feel like you're alone in that situation. But for most circumstances, when it comes to child abuse or any sexual abuse in that matter, even as an adult, I think that there's so many people that go through it that, honestly, I would say that you could never feel alone in that category, because it's a millions of them. And I think, too, because we're running out of time, but I think, too, for parents who have experienced it, I think that is important that they share those experiences with their children. Now, I could be wrong on this, because I don't have no kids. I'm not sure how this works psychologically. But I think that it's important that maybe perhaps you share that experience just so that they are aware. And maybe this could even be therapeutic for that parent who hasn't actually, you know, faced
it.
Exactly. So this could actually be therapeutic for them and educate their kids, so that, you know, you can try to do the best that you can to see that it doesn't happen. And trust me, even sometimes your best effort is not going to stop it from happening.
Go ahead, I'm sorry.
No, that was it. That's what I was saying.
Oh, okay. But you know what I was just thinking? Now we've talked about as far as the conflict in the relationships, you know, how would it affect the relationships. Now, it can be also to where you have, as a child, you have experienced this sexual abuse.
Mm-hmm.
Then as you get into a relationship, and once again, when you when you're facing that as a child and then you grow up, your self-esteem goes.
Right.
That could be the first thing. I'm not saying that it is, but, you know, it could be.
Could be.
Your self-esteem goes. So it's like you get in these relationships, that, an unhealthy relationship that can lead to where you're getting beat on. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
A domestic relationship, domestic violence. So,
mm-hmm.
That's just an example, like, to where it can lead, that sexual abuse you had can lead you into all these unhealthy relationships because you don't want to feel left alone. So you're gonna accept this person that's in your life, whatever he's doing or she's doing to you.
Right.
Because you feel that nobody wants you anyway, because you feel like that's how you feel. Your self-esteem is gone. Somebody took that from you. Somebody took your innocence from you. So the first person that stepped up, oh, he want me or she want me. Oh, and you know what I'm saying? And then you're gonna accept that abuse from this person because you think that's cool as long as they want to be with you. You know
exactly,
what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So that, like, once again, I know I've said this already, but I'm gonna keep saying it because it's the truth. This goes so deep. Seriously, it's so deep. It's deep because we're talking about young children that's getting sexually abused, and they're carrying it on into their adult life.
Right.
And they don't know how to handle it, or their parents didn't handle it correctly, or their parents just brushed it off, or however you want to put it.
Right.
But it's causing not even conflict in relationships, but conflict in society. Period. Because you go out here, if it hasn't been addressed, you go out here and you just be doing crazy stuff because you just got all kinds of shit going on, all kind of mixed emotions going on inside.
Right.
So you're doing
right.
crazy stuff. You're breaking in people's houses, raping people, and stuff like that. I'm just saying. I'm not necessarily saying that the people are
what
here doing because they're sexual abuse.
But
it could
be.
That could be the reason. You know what I'm saying? And they don't know how to deal with that shit. And that's one of the reasons. I'm going to say that's probably one of the reasons why we have so much stuff going on out here. So,
right.
yeah, I just thought I'd throw that out there because that is exactly what's happening. The domestic violence because some issues they haven't addressed when they was a child or as an adult that, you know, shit that happened to them as a child.
Yeah, I can definitely agree with that, and I believe that 100%. I mean, you would be surprised, how much criminal activity is spurred by some type of abuse, even sexual abuse as a child. Like you would be surprised because I know we categorize it as, you know, sexual abuse, but at the end of the day, it's abuse. So it may not trigger. It may not trigger a sexual response, just meaning that because you've been sexually abused doesn't necessarily mean that you'll sexually abuse someone else, but it may trigger other things.
It can cause all kinds of things. It all depends on that person. You know, one thing may trigger one person, something else for another person. So you just know.
Right,
yeah.
Definitely. I agree with you. Yeah, that's a pretty deep conversation. I mean, almost a conversation that we can break up into two parts. To be honest, like, we could actually
right.
come back to this next week. I mean, we'll discuss it after we get off the air, but we definitely could because I hadn't even gotten into, what I had seen on the story about Pam Grier. You know what I'm saying? So that was a whole different dynamic when it came to sexual abuse. Because real quick, I just shoot on it. She had been abused as a child, so she ended up moving, like, I think it was with her grandfather or something, and they ended up setting her up on a date, which she ended up getting sexually abused by, you know, the dudes. So, like, it kind of happened to her, you know, two times. And then how she was saying, basically she was saying how she got caught in a catch-22 because her family was to a point where she knew that if she told, I believe it was either her granddaddy or her father, I can't remember, but she said she knew if she told them that they would kill him. Like, literally, it wasn't no ifs, ands, buts about it. So she got caught in the catch-22 because she said she didn't want the dude to get killed and she didn't want to lose her father to the system. So, like, yeah. She literally didn't say anything because she didn't want that to happen. So that's a whole other dynamic.
Yeah. And there's a lot of that going on to where a person, the child is not going to tell. Because certainly if it's a close friend, a family member, they're not going to tell because they probably looking like, this is a family member. They may not believe me anyway. So I'm just going to shut my mouth. You know what I'm saying? Right. So, yeah, it's definitely all of that. There's a lot of that going on. I'm sure it is.
Yeah, definitely. For sure. Yeah, we got real deep, man. We gonna discuss that off the air, but we can jump back on this next week. We can go with a part two. You know what I'm saying? Because it's still some more stuff that we need to address. So
yeah,
I mean, we haven't even gotten into the actual adult relationship. So we can go at this again next week. I think I'm comfortable with doing that. You know, we don't have to agree to it on air right now, but I'm comfortable with doing. I think we need to address it further and go into like a part two. You feel me?
Yeah.
But on that note, man, we talked y'all ear off for an hour. You know what I'm saying? I wanna thank everybody who checked us out on eblockradio.com. Everybody that checked us out on Blog Talk Radio. Everyone who called in and was afraid to say anything, it's okay. You get a second chance next week because we're gonna get back on this topic, man. But great discussion, and I can't wait to get back to it next week. I can't wait to see you next week. I just can't wait to do a lot of stuff.
I'm excited.
I'm excited too, man. Hey, look, on that note, though, we're about to get up out of here. And as always, man, thank you to everybody that checked us out today. Wholeheartedly and sincerely, I got to clean it up for the He Say, She Say show. Because otherwise, normally I'm a little bit loose. I'm a loose shooter. But on that note, man, we up out here. We're going to check y'all out next week, man. You know what it is. It's your boy, the Hood Howard Stern, Q Lewis, and my lovely co-host,
CoCo J. Y'all have a blessed and safe weekend.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Oh, yeah, shout out to birthday. Shout out to Daisy. You know, happy birthday, Daisy.
Happy birthday to my sister, Daisy. She turned 24 today. We may be heading out to the casino. So happy birthday to my little sister, Daisy.
All right, man. We're about it, dog. Peace out, y'all.
All right, peace.